First thing I want to say, and that many of you might have thought when I came here and started speaking, not when you saw me, but when I started speaking, is, hey, where's this guy from? You know, right? Where are you from? Obviously, I have an accent. Duh. Where are you from is a question I get asked frequently, including by some people at the conference already. And this is a question that some of you might have asked, folks who have an accent or who don't look like you are mainstream American. You know, some of you, I see some of you nodding your heads who don't look like you're mainstream American. This is a common question. Now, from my accent, some of you might have guessed that, you know, where I'm from. Forget about it, I'm from New York. No, really, my accent is not from New York, but I did live in New York for over a decade. When my parents came to the United States when I was 10, from a small country called the Republic of Moldova, after the Berlin Wall fell down in 1991. So Berlin Wall fell in 1989, my parents came in 1991. There's Moldova right there. It's well known as one of the least happy places in the world. So I'm really glad that they left. Didn't want to grow up there. And we came, settled in New York City, as I mentioned. Now, we were very poor. We were dirt poor when we settled in. You know, we lived in roach-infested tenement apartments. It was really hard for me to get to school. My parents couldn't afford a bus pass, and the school was about 2 miles away, so I had to walk to the school every day, 2 miles, uphill in the snow, both ways. No, really, there were two hills. So that was the situation in which I grew up, and I was fortunate that my dad actually found a job in an Italian bakery delivering bread. So at least we always had bread that fell off the back of the truck. And we had to get furniture that was discarded by people. You know, they discarded the furniture for garbage trucks to pick up, so we would go, we'd pick it up, we'd drag it over to our house. And so that was kind of the situation in which we lived. Now, fortunately, when we got to the house, we had some help. You haven't lived until you've seen a couch dragged up the stairs by 300 cockroaches. So it was a tough life for me in that time. But you know what? I chose not to drop my accent. There were many people at that time who came from an Eastern European background, like I did, who chose to drop their accents. And I saw them, and I know why they chose to drop their accents. I talked to them. They weren't proud of their cultural background. They wanted to fit in. They wanted to be part of the mainstream. Now, I was always a bit of a contrarian, and I didn't want to fit in. Yes, that made me a good speaker. So I didn't want to fit in, and I also was proud of my cultural heritage. I was proud of my background, even though it was the least happy country in the world, or one of the least happy countries in the world. And so I decided to retain my accent. Now, I later found out that was a kind of a dumb decision, to be honest, because of a phenomenon that's known as accent discrimination. Accent discrimination is the false perception of being less trustworthy by people who have a foreign accent. There's only one accent that this doesn't apply to in the United States. Can you guess which one?
British,
great, yes. We still have that cultural imperialism, you know, going. They still have that cultural imperialism going for them. So that's the only accent to which it doesn't apply. So that's a phenomenon of accent discrimination.